Okay, so we have one more problem to do revolving around the Zeroth law of thermodynamics. And as I said, it's a little bit more convoluted. Here we have 350 grams of ethanol with a heat capacity of 2.44 joules gram degrees Celsius being held at 10 degrees Celsius. So that's the temperature, the initial temperature of ethanol. We're mixing this with 200 grams of water, which has a heat capacity of 4.184 joules gram degrees Celsius at 70 degrees. That's the initial temperature of water. And we are adding 50 grams of copper with a heat capacity of 0.385 joules gram degrees Celsius at an initial temperature of 50 degrees Celsius. We want to find out what is the temperature of this entire mixture. In a first look, this may seem a little bit overwhelming, but one thing to be noticed is that the temperatures of the three substances, 10 degrees, 70 degrees, and 50 degrees, have something in particular about them. For one, the 10 degrees Celsius is by default the lowest temperature, the coldest temperature, if you will. And the 70 degrees Celsius is the hottest temperature. So you, in essence, have a setup for Q hot equals negative Q cold. The question, of course, becomes, well, what happens to the copper that has an initial temperature of 50 degrees Celsius? In some problems, you might have to deliver a trial and error, and based on your final answer, see if what you did makes any sense or not. And what that implies is that your final answer will have to have a temperature in between all of the initial ones, and if not, then you made a mistake. Now, the trial and error that I'm talking about is that the 50 degrees Celsius, so the copper data, could either go with Q hot or it could go with Q cold. Now, the fact that it is semi-close to the 70 degrees Celsius, at least a little closer to 70 degrees Celsius than it is to 10 degrees Celsius, I would personally think, okay, that might still be hot from the point of view of ethanol. So I'm going to associate copper and water as being the hot substances. And so what that means is that my Q hot now has two terms, one of them associated with water and the other one associated with copper. And the Q cold for this setup, I'm just saying the Q cold is just ethanol and nothing but ethanol. All right, it's after the fact that we'll find out whether our assumption about copper makes sense or not. For now, we're kind of guessing. But we're gonna input all of the values, and bear with me because since we have so many numbers to play with, I had to get rid of units and the numbers are gonna be a little bit small. But the idea is that all the grams and joules per gram degree Celsius are gonna cancel out on left and right sides of the equation. All you'll have is degrees Celsius as your final unit. But look at what we've done right here. On the first term for the hot stuff, we have the 200 grams of water multiplied by the 4.184 joules per gram degree Celsius heat capacity. That's being multiplied by the final temperature, which we don't know what it is, minus the initial temperature for the water. And for water, the initial temperature was 70 degrees Celsius. All right, that takes care of water. Now copper. Copper, we have 50 grams worth of mass, a heat capacity of 0.385, and a final temperature that we don't know, but we know that that'll be the same as the other final temperature that we have in the first Q term, minus the initial temperature of the copper, and that is the 50 degrees Celsius, okay? So that takes care of Q hat as a whole. For Q cold, we make sure to place that negative in front of the entire MCAT term, so negative, followed by the mass of the cold stuff, which is ethanol, so 350 grams of ethanol, so we have 350. We have the specific heat capacity of ethanol, 2.44, and we have initial temperature for the cold stuff of 10 degrees Celsius, so we have TF minus 10 degrees Celsius. All right, so we're good to go. What's gonna happen right now is that the easiest thing to do in this problem is to multiply the two numbers outside of the change in temperature. So the 200 by 4.184, multiply those two numbers. The 50 multiplied by the 0.385, carry on that multiplication. the negative 350 and the 2.44, multiply those numbers together, and you'll end up with the following semi-simplified version of the equation. 836.8 times TF minus 70 plus 19.25 times TF minus 50 being equal to negative 854 times TF minus 10 degrees Celsius. Okay, now here you can go many different ways about solving the problem. The way that I decide to do it is to divide every single term by 836.8. That basically allows me to end up with TF minus 70 by itself. Then you have 19.25 divided by 836.8 yields 0.023. And negative 854 divided by 836.8 gives negative 1.021, multiplying, you know, TF minus 10 degrees Celsius. All right, so now at this point, you have no choice but to distribute. So we're going to multiply 0.023 by TF and by negative 50. And we're going to multiply negative 1.021 by TF and negative 10. And this will yield the following numbers. TF minus 70 plus 0.023 TF minus 1.150. And that will equal negative 1.021 TF plus 10.21. All right, now, like the previous examples that we did, what you want to do is get all the TF terms on the same side. So that means that we will add 1.021 TF to both sides. And we want to bring all the non-TF terms to the opposite side. So add 70 and add 1.150 to both sides. This will give you the following setup, right? TF plus 0.023 TF plus 1.021 TF equals 10.21 plus 70 plus 1.150. When you carry the actual summations, you'll find out that those summations end up being 2.044 TF equaling 81.36. And if you divide both numbers by 2.044 to isolate for the final temperature, you'll find out that the temperature is 39.8 degrees Celsius. And the beauty of this is that 39.8 not only lies in between 10 degrees Celsius and 70 degrees Celsius, but it also lies in between 50 degrees Celsius and 10 degrees Celsius. So that means that we did the correct thing. We, assuming that copper was a hot substance, was actually correct, because we're yielding a value that's still in between 50 and 10. So that's kind of what you want to see. The final temperature should be lower than all of the hot temperatures, but it should be higher than all of the cold temperatures. That needs to happen. All right, so this does it for the Zeroth law of thermodynamics. This was a complex example, but it's an example that I recommend you paying attention to. Maybe redoing it on your own. There'll be homework problems that will probably deal with this type of setup where you have multiple things happening and you have to distribute the heat to each one correspondingly. All right, with that being said, we'll stop with this video and move on to the next one.